It takes just 4 steps to get brilliant shading in your design and animation, and they are way easier than you might think. I'm going to show you my exact formula to achieve this in After Effects, plus 2 new techniques that I discovered while making this animation that, if I'd have known earlier, I'd probably be on Mars by now. My brief was to make toothpaste look as delicious as possible. If you don't want to eat it by the end of this video, I have failed. I designed it in Procreate. I animated the squeeze frame by frame using CaliPeg across just 12 frames. To make it super crisp, I cleaned it up using shape layers in After Effects, animating the shape path and nudging each position to match the roughs. Clean as a whistle. Whistle. Now the shading. The form shadow defines the 3D form. This is a circle, and now this is a sphere. It shows which area isn't getting hit from the main light source. Now our light source is towards the top, creating a subtle form shadow underneath. For a basic shape, I would simply duplicate the layer, make its fill darker, draw a mask over where I would like the shading, and increase the feather property on that mask to get a softer shadow. Because this is a little more complicated and it moves, we've got an even cleverer option. We can duplicate our main paste layer, add a fill effect with a darker gray, invert it, so now it's filling up everything that isn't our paste, move it up just a bit, and then check preserve underlying transparency. So now it only shows over the layers underneath, and then add a blur and soften it to our liking. Ambient occlusion sounds complicated, but it is just where the light cannot reach into the small gaps. For our toothpaste, it is these folds. So on a new dark solid, using preserve underlying transparency again, and we'll set it to multiply, I drew a mask with the pen tool, added a soft feather to it, and got it to look how we want across this side of the arc. Now to remove this left section, where we don't want any shadow, I drew another mask. This time, set it to subtract, so it cuts away from that first mask, which looks close. And instead of softening that mask with the feather property, I used my new favorite tool, the mask feather tool, which lets you vary the amount of feather along the mask. So there's no feather here and lots of feather here. And we get this super satisfying fall off for that shadow, and we can really feel that crease. Highly underrated tool. I animated the mask paths for the few frames where they are in motion and did the same for the bottom two folds. Reflected light is the light that is reflected off another surface that can also take its color. And this makes a lot of shading feel refined. One way to do this is to create a lighter solid on top, add a mask, feather it, and use your object as a mat. And now we've got light bouncing up from the bottom. But because our paste is rounded and it will be subtle, we can wrap the light around the whole shape. So we'll duplicate our main paste layer, move that on top of everything, and we'll rename that to paste reflected light because we always label our layers. We'll change its fill from white to black, and add the layer style inner glow. Then we set that layer's blending mode to screen, and that wraps around the whole shape, reflected light that follows the edge. The highlights are the brightest spots where the light reflects right into your eyeball and makes glossy surfaces look extra shiny. For this design, it's pretty simple. I've made some rounded strokes and animated their path across just a few frames. If they were on a rougher surface, we could blur those to make it softer, but I want this toothpaste to look juicy, so they stay sharp. Now for the real dessert, that delicious minty gel swirl, inspired by the uncontested greatest ever aesthetic, Frutiger Aero. I cleaned up the rough animation again with a shape layer, and because translucent objects like a gem or gel show light escaping through the opposite side of the light source, I added a gradient ramp effect to that swirl, going from blue to cyan. To add more contrast, I animated a feathered mask on a blue solid to hug the top edge of the swirl, and I wanted it to really glow and feel exciting in there, like some sort of nuclear plasma rave. So I added a feathered, even brighter cyan solid to the bottom and animated a turbulent displace effect on it to make it dance. And again with an even more intense white solid on the bottom. Then for the glittery, delicious microplastic sparkles in the gel. This was what I was most looking forward to. There is a relatively obscure effect in After Effects called card wipe, which creates this wonderfully goofy transition. But if you apply it to a white solid, shrink the pieces, and add some random rotation, it looks a lot like squares of glitter, with actual depth and lighting that changes based on their angle. Brilliant. I use the swirl layer as a mat, turned the blending mode to overlay, added a curves effect to increase the contrast. Now with just a bit of animation to its position, it feels like they've been squeezed out with the paste and are slowly floating around in there, patiently waiting to unleash an unholy freshness. Also, if you've got a colored transparent object on top of something, you can add a blurred duplicate of that layer, leaving the color shining through and get a really realistic and fun effect, kind of like a magical drop shadow. That's what I did for this Apple logo. Now, not every project requires all these shading steps, and you might want to add more, a good old cast shadow that I didn't need to use here. Bold, stylized shading, textured shading, no shading, shade shading, they are all beautiful in their own way. Go one step at a time and trust the process. For at least 2 minutes, twice a day. And floss the process on the weekend as a treat. Now, knowing how and when to use these techniques does take a little bit of practice and experience, but any animation you see out there in the wild was made by real people just like you. You can make the amazing work that you see out there. It may seem impossibly difficult trying to balance the idea, the design, the timing, the story, the easing, the effects, all at once. But once you break it down into steps, it is all very achievable. And each one of those steps can be broken down further and further. I've been teaching motion design for many years to thousands of students. Here are just some of the incredible student projects that have come out of my courses. I've spent years putting these together and squeezed everything I know about motion design into them. I focus on teaching not just the specific techniques to get the result you want, but also why you would make certain decisions in certain situations, and really just how to think like a motion designer in order to solve any design or animation problem that you come up against. Along the way, cementing those abilities and knowledge in fun, practical projects to really build out and upgrade your portfolio. To learn with me, go to benmarriott.com. I'll see you there.